heat wave, a tropical heat wave. Temperatures rise.
The town was alive. It was just alive, you know. Especially Jackson, down Jackson Street.
Seattle was screaming 24/7. I mean, around the clock. It never stopped.
They're all private clubs. Whiskey by the drink.
It was the Colored Elks, the Black Elks.
I had a distant relative that owned the 908 Club.
She's playing the breakfast show at the 411.
It was called the Basin Street. Well, I worked that club quite a bit.
The Black and Tan, sometimes known as the Waiters and Porters.
I did a lot of the military bases with Rachel, R.C.
Sessions Playhouse.
I met Nat King Cole in his club, the Rocking Chair. Everybody went to the Rocking Chair. You could hardly get in to one of these clubs. It was so crowded. I mean, there would be lines of people waiting to get in, you know?
It was usually three gigs a night, and it was a proper gig, or dinner music, you know, from 7 to 10 at the tennis club or something like that, with cup mutes and all that. Then we'd go play either Washington Social Club or Rockin' Chair or Rockin' Tan or something. And then afterwards, everybody would just, for our souls, we'd go to the Elks Club to play bebop and jam all night.
Usually the clubs had what they called a floor show, and that meant that they had at least three acts. They had a singer, a dancer, shake dancer, or maybe a comedian, or a magician, or something, you know, but three acts. And it would change weekly. So you got to see a lot of different acts and different people coming through town working these clubs. We used to all dress in the same dressing room. I worked with a lot of female impersonators and things like that, and you know, it was nothing. If anything, there was so much laughter going on behind stage, in the dressing rooms, that the people were missing the real show. You know, I used to think the clubs that I worked in had a light in the dressing room, a red light, and when that light would go on, that meant that there was a raid either in progress or going about to happen. And so they would spirit me out the back, you know, because they could really, really get into a lot of trouble with a teenager in a club like that. It was exciting to me. It was, you know, more fun than I could have had, you know. Sitting at home or in a classroom, or to me, you know, this was adventure, you know. Anywhere you live, you have to leave home before you're accepted at home. When I was 16, I announced to my family that when I'm 18, I'm gonna go on the road with a band. And as luck would have it, the band came through town when I was 18, and I went on the road with the band, you know.
When she went out of town with Johnny Otis' band, that was a big deal. This young lady is going on the road with the band that made Harlem Nocturne, which was a big hit during the late 40s.
When she first came out of the gate, I think she went out with Johnny Otis once, so we were always excited to see her come back, you know, to hear all the stories about the war stories on the road and with a big professional band. It was just a disease we had.
In those days, that's what you did, and that's how you honed your craft, by working with a big band and therefore being able to work in front of large audiences, you know.
She went to Los Angeles to make it on her own. She made her first record on Black and White Records. I think it was 1949.
I think they must have printed 25 of them or something like that. And there were a few places in Los Angeles that had it on the jukebox. We'd go to wherever these songs were on the jukebox and listen to the songs on the jukebox. And to me, that was, then I thought I was really, you know, oh, this is it, you know.
She went back out in 51 with Lionel Hampton. And that was the great Lionel Hampton band with Quincy Jones, Clifford Brown, the bass player Monk Montgomery.
Those days, that was the way life was. I mean, you know, yeah, man, Steen is singing. Wow. I've never heard her sing this good, you know. Man, she is really swinging. Words like that, they were indefinite, you know, not necessarily definitive words or terms, and they didn't very well say what it was you were trying to get across. But nevertheless, we all understood each other. And if you said somebody was really swinging, that meant that they had some new stuff that you hadn't heard out of them before. And then you attributed it to the fact that she was on the road with Hampton and she was hanging out with people like Art Farmer and all of these heavyweight musicians who were some of our idols. And although we all later became colleagues.
I always had to come home. You know, no matter where I lived, and I've lived in a lot of places, and but I always come home. And mainly because my family was here.
When skies are cloudy and gray, they're only gray for a day.
Her talent was so obvious to people that various promoters like Bumps Blackwell picked her up immediately and started to promote her. And she started singing with Quincy and Bumps' band that Quincy and Buddy Catlett and all the local guys were in.
Ernestine Anderson was with us too, and Ernestine played enough. She was singing together and working together when I was 15.
Quincy Jones was just starting to become a good writer. He was only 15, 16 years old, but he wrote most of the book, which was pop tunes of the day, and they were not all blues.
Well, we were just kids together, you know, and we were working and we were doing what we love to do, you know, music, and that was exciting. And so, you know, we just did what normal kids do, you know, hang around. Whoever had money enough to buy the newest record, like a Dizzy Gillespie record or a Charlie Parker record, we would all go to that person's house and listen to these records and learn the solos. And if you couldn't sing the solos, then you were not cool.
Why haven't we heard about this exciting new singer before? Where's she been? Well, the fact is that she's been in Sweden. She's a homegrown product, all right, by way of Seattle and San Francisco. But it took a trip halfway around the world for Ernestine Anderson to be recognized as an important new vocalist in jazz. In 1956, she toured Scandinavia and was an immediate success. Daily newspapers ran front-page pictures of Ernestine. Magazines did two-page features about her.
And when she went to Sweden, she was immediately adopted there. They called her Stina in Stockholm. You know, that quality, that reserve that she has is catching.
When I went to Sweden, it was my first time being out of the country, out of, you know. What I found there was I was accepted for who I was and not for the color of my skin or, you know, none of that. And it was the first time I had felt, first time I really knew what it felt like to be free, totally. I came home feeling that everyone, black, white, yellow, brown, you know, everyone should experience this at least one time in their lives, you know.
Important discovery, a new jazz singer. With that headline in his column in the San Francisco Chronicle a few weeks ago, the jazz critic Ralph Gleason heralded the appearance of a new major jazz singing talent. Gleason said, Ernestine Anderson sings with conviction, taste, and emotion, and she improvises with the feeling of inevitability that is the mark of the true jazz artist.
Eventually in the 50s, she began to assert her own style, a kind of lighter, more swinging style. Her voice in those days was clear and light and pure. It floated, it had a kind of punch and swing. It's like you think, wait a minute, that's not Ella Fitzgerald. That's not Sarah Vaughan. Who is that? That's Ernestine Anderson in the 50s, and there was nobody like her.
There might be many other nights like this, and I'll be standing here with someone new. There may be other songs to sing, and I'll fall another spring. There will never be another you. There might be other lips that I may kiss, but they won't thrill me like your kiss do. Now I may dream a million dreams, how can they come true if there will never, ever be another you? There might be many other nights like this, and I'll be standing here with someone new. Maybe other songs to sing, another fall, another spring.
The club that I was hired to just manage, there was no TV at that time. Our hours were 10, five, six nights a week. Our hours from 10 at night until 5 in the morning. And then the dice girl and I would, or me alone, whatever, we'd go out to catch the breakfast show at the 4-11. And Ernestine was singing with a band that was headed by Ernie Lewis. And she captured me immediately. I mean, she was just marvelous.
He had this phenom, this young, phenomenal singer. Her name was Ernestine Anderson. And I remember that's the first time I caught her was at one of the concerts in a theater just off campus at the university. Oh, amazing. All the divas were still alive then. I'm talking about Ella Fitzgerald and Sarah Vaughan and all of those kinds of people. They were still around, but so she was a bit derivative then, but she had her own thing. It was clear she was who she was, a new commodity.
And I thought I would never sing again when I first heard Sarah Vaughan sing. I thought that is just what she's doing is impossible, you know, for the human voice to do. I can't do it, and so I quit. I felt like if I'm gonna sing, this is how I wanna sing. And I had a little setback there for, you know, a minute. Dinah Washington, I loved dearly. When I moved to New York at one point, she just took me on, you know, took me under her wings and introduced me to everybody in New York, including Miles Davis. And everybody would end up at Birdland in those days in the 50s. You know, all the musicians after their gigs, everybody would come to Birdland. So you could meet everybody there. And you did meet everybody there. So it was wonderful times, you know.
From 64 to 66, rock and roll had become the music of America, and jazz people couldn't get work. So I moved to London. That was my home base, and I worked all over Europe.
You've got the look of love. It's on. In your face, the look that time can't erase. Be mine tonight. Let this be just the start of so many nights like this.
When I came back in 66, nobody knew who I was, and it was like starting all over again. And I just didn't have the stamina or the desire to do that.
The retirement is a representation of one she always longed to be home. preferred to be home and felt an obligation to be home.
When my daughter told me she was expecting, well, this just, you know, I thought, well, okay, this is what I want to do. So I came home, and my first grandbaby was born.
She started again with Elmer Gill about the mid to late 70s, a venue in Canada.
Ray Brown appeared on the scene and asked me to do a jazz festival kind of thing on Vancouver Island. And then he booked me at the Concord Jazz Festival where they recorded me. And the next thing I knew, I was back in the business again.
And that's what I hear in the Ernestine that came back in the 70s. I hear wisdom. I hear a kind of reserve. I hear a kind of willingness to stand back and look, like in that song, you never make your move too soon. I mean, to me, that epitomizes the new Ernestine.
And she had developed, matured a great deal. I mean, not that she wasn't mature before, but she'd found out who Ernestine was.
Day by day, I'm falling more in love with you. And day by day, my love seems to grow. There isn't any end to my devotion. It's deeper, dear by far, than any ocean. And I find day by day, you're making all my dreams come true. So come what may, I want you to know, I'm yours alone and I'm in love to stay. We go through this day by day. Day by day, I'm falling more in love with you. And day by day, my love seems to grow. There ain't no end to my devotion. It's deeper, dear Papa, than any ocean. I find that day by day, you're making all my dreams come true. So come what may, I want you to know, I am yours alone and I'm in love to stay. As we go through the year, day by day.
And in jazz, you know, that was an unwritten law. You didn't have to stick to the script, you know. however far out you could go and still remain intact, you know, and be able to get back to the basics, then you were learning your skill.
I'm yours alone and I'm in love to stay. We go through this. Chomp, 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 chomp,
she has those timeless values in jazz. These aren't things that you can learn out of a book. She swings, she's got blues, and she's got style. That's the reason she survived as a singer. She's got those qualities that you earn by paying dues, by really studying the music and studying your predecessors. I mean, Ernestine knows the music. She knows everything from Louis Armstrong right up to what happened when she was a kid. She follows what's going on.
She was considered the heiress to Ella and Sarah. No joke, and still is. She was a monster, and she sang everything too. She could style standards like nobody. She was just amazing.
Deeper, deeper, deeper. As we go through the years, day, day, by day.
I don't think I'm successful. I don't know what is success.
You know, what is it? How do you describe success? I think maybe waking up and getting out of bed is some kind of success to me at this age. You know, I mean, just being able to greet each day is, to me, success.
A person's music can be no more or less than they are as a human being. That's really true. Ernestine's a great lady.
I will be seeing you. When I'm singing, I'm happy. It's something I enjoy doing. It's something I don't think I ever, I can't see me ever being without. You know, as long as I'm breathing, I'm singing. I love it. I absolutely love it.
Think of you that way. I'll find you in the morning sun. And when the night is new. Looking at the moon, but I'll be seeing you. I'll be seeing you.
There might be many other nights like this, and I'll be standing here with someone new. Maybe other songs to sing, another fall, another spring. There will never be another you. There might be other lips that I may kiss, but they won't thrill me like yours used to do. I may dream a million dreams, how can they come true if there will never ever be another you? There might be many other nights like this. I'll be standing here with someone new. Maybe other songs to sing, another fall, another spring. There will never be another you. Might be other lips I may kiss. They won't thrill me like yours used to do. Now I may dream a million dreams. How can they come true if there will never ever be another you?
My mind is more at ease. Whoa, but nevertheless, why stir up memories? Been invited on dates, could have gone, but what for? I couldn't stand it without you. Don't get around much anymore, just couldn't bear it without. Don't get around much anymore.
Hi, welcome to yoga. My name is Emily. I am the yoga and fitness instructor at the Pike Market Senior Center. And I'm just really excited to be in collaboration with the Seattle Channel and extend our community practice to the viewers at home. So thank you so much for being here. The Pike Market Senior Center has been offering yoga classes for over a decade, and many of my students have been practicing much longer than I have. So it's a very experienced group of folks. So just know that the classes that we offer here are a little bit vigorous. Please just take it at your own pace, push and pull on the offering in whatever way makes the most sense for you and your body. Keep an open mind and do your best. All right, let's have a great class. All right, hi, welcome. If you aren't already, let's go ahead and get started at the top of the mat. And as always, you're welcome to begin in a seat if seated feels a little bit better for you today. That's a great way to start as well. But however you like to begin, most importantly, give yourself just a couple breaths here to very intentionally slow down and start to welcome yourself into the moment. So maybe with your eyes open, just take a second to move your vision away from the TV or the screen and to observe your space. And even if this is a room you've been in a bajillion times, just notice the light. What time of day is it? The colors, the objects. Looking, noticing. And we'll take that same attitude of curiosity and awareness and start to bring it internal. So if it feels good, you can close down your eyes or maybe just find a soft gaze down in front of you. But taking just a couple breaths here to check in and to notice how things are feeling for you today. What's the felt sense of your body? Sometimes we come to our physical practice and what we meet isn't just physical. Often it's very energetic or emotional, mental. And so just sort of noticing all the different aspects of you. And as always, as we kind of transition into this practice, remember that it's never about having a perfect experience or the right experience. It's about the discipline to have the experience you're actually having with a little bit of curiosity and a lot of compassion. We're going to meet this moment, this experience with breath. Take a big breath in. Open mouth, exhale. Let's do one more just like that. Breathe in. Breathe out. Good. I invite you to relax your arms down. I don't know why I always like to bring my hands to my hips when I do this, but just do what feels comfortable for you. Nice and rooted through your feet. Let's take a couple moments here just to gently turn the head around in gentle little circles here on your neck. If you find a place that feels a little sticky or tight, you're welcome to pause and give it a breath or a little extra stretch. Be gentle. And let's gently reverse that direction. Let yourself come back up through neutral. We're going to start to shrug the shoulders up and back. See, just kind of be curious, right? When we kind of bring our shoulders up to our ears, that tends to kind of be like a stress pattern or a holding pattern. So as you lift your shoulders up, see if you can do it with a sense of strength and support, not necessarily with like clenching or sort of stressing, just kind of allowing mobility, really, and range of motion come into this whole upper area of your body, right? Your shoulders, your chest, your upper back, your neck. Let's reverse that action, right? Bringing the shoulders forward and down, kind of get that good stretch through the back of the shoulder blades. And just meeting it again with breath. You might imagine your breath moving into these areas of the body. Go ahead and relax that down. Bring your hands out in front of you and open your palms. And I'm going to encourage you to really look at your hands. The hands are such cool and powerful and creative and communicative, and they're just incredible parts of our body. All those little bones in the hands, your fingerprint is unique to you. Right. Let's go ahead and close the hands into a gentle little fist and make some circles here. Feeling, listening, snap, crackle, popping. And we'll reverse the direction. Go ahead and open up your hands, spread your fingers nice and wide, nice good stretch through your palms, and then close your fingers in. So open and close. Good, keep them open, wiggle your fingers, make sure you get your thumbs. And bring the hands to the hips. Feet hip-width distance, at least maybe a little bit wider. You can be soft through your knees here. We're gonna make big circles. Really turning the pelvis around in a big circle, right? Letting it move on top of the thigh bones. Even though, you know, you can't actually, I hear yoga teachers all the time say, you know, breathe into your hips. You know, our lungs don't go into our hips. But what the intention here is to know that when we do these poses, we're creating all of this space, right? We're creating space in all of these tissues. And as we breathe, the breath oxygenates, right? The whole body, all of the cells, the blood, right? So you might breathe nourishment and space and compassion into the hips. Let's swing it around the other way. Our hip joints are incredibly important, obviously, and they're notoriously tricky. So be gentle. Know that you're doing good work just by letting your hips take up some space. Good. And go ahead and stand up nice and tall. I'm going to turn to the side just to demo. I bring your awareness into your back body, weight into your heels, gently hinge at your knees here, like sticking your butt back in space like you were going to sit down, but then drive through your heels and stand yourself back up. So it's just a little lower and a lift. Nice and slow. We're going to start to build a little bit of heat. Start to kick on a little energy in the big muscles of the lower body. Sort of noticing, right? As always, you're welcome to rest or take a different variation. Move as fast or as slow makes sense to you. But see if you can kind of ride alongside the sensation, the activation, right? The heart rate comes up a little bit, the warmth of the body. See if you can kind of ride alongside that sensation with curiosity, knowing that when things get challenging, that doesn't necessarily mean that you're bad at it or wrong or that, you know, something wrong is happening. Right? We actually build a lot of capacity and strength mentally by learning how to just kind of be embodied during these moments of activation. Going at your own pace, I'm going to say we're here last 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, good, stand up, give yourself a breath. I definitely feel warmed up. We'll start to do a little sun salutation and some flexion of the spine. Lots of good work in the spine for this class. So let's take a deep breath in, reach your arms up. Exhale, bring your hands to heart center. Two more just like that, inhale, arms up. Exhale, hands to heart center. This time, inhale, arms up. You listen, exhale, side bend, up and over to the left. Right, strong through your belly and your feet here, lifting up and over, right, to bring some space through the side body, the right side rib cage. And strong through the belly, let's come back up through center and give yourself a breath in. Exhale, side bending over to the right. And same deal, nice and slow, stay present. Doesn't need to be a huge movement or a big sensation to be interesting or effective. Let's come back up through center. And exhale, relax your arms down, and we're gonna work into a standing supported back bend. So start, even though we're working in the spine, start with your ground, right? So feet are hip-width distance, nice and rooted through your legs, strong through your legs. And bring your hands to your lower back, kind of like the top of the butt here, and then bring your shoulder blades and your elbows toward one another, and just kind of feel how that in itself is gonna start to kind of push the sternum and the chest forward, right? So that might be a good and interesting place to stay. If you wanna go a little bit deeper, again, strong through your legs, engage your quadriceps, squeeze your butt together, literally squeeze your glutes, and then start to push your hips forward, right? And you'll notice that that deepens the back bend quite a bit. That might be where you stay. Maybe you lift through your sternum and look up. All right, I know some of my students will take their gaze all the way to the back wall, but wherever you're looking, stay with the ground underneath your feet. We're here just for three. Lift your chest in two and one. Take that big breath in and reach your arms up. Good, exhale, relax your arms down. All right, we're gonna work some forward bending, right? So we just did backward bending, now we're gonna do forward bending. So bending the knees generously to begin, right? Let this really be about decompression of the lower spine. Bring your hands to your thighs or your knees here. Let the tailbone pull back in space and reach the crown of your head forward. And as always, this is gonna be where a lot of us do our work. We're gonna stay just like this. Others of you are gonna start to dangle forward, reaching for the floor or your toes. Right, keep that bend in your knees and then press yourself up. Inhale, arms up, reach up. Good, exhale, relax your arms down to your side. And just give yourself a moment to pause. We're gonna do that forward bend three times with breath, so linking the breath to the poses, vinyasa yoga. And then on the third one, we're gonna hold it for time. So just keep your ears open and do your best. Inhale, arms up, reach up. Exhale, fold forward halfway or all the way. Drive through your heels, inhale, arms up. Exhale, halfway or all the way. One more, inhale, reach up. Exhale, halfway or all the way, and pause. Right, again, just a moment to notice ground. Let yourself feel rooted and supported. And from that sense of support, do your best to relax through your spine, your face, your jaw. Nice deep breaths. Good. If you are bending all the way forward, bend your knees and let's come up halfway, right? So give yourself a moment, let your blood pressure kind of calibrate. And then drive through your heels, take a big breath in to reach all the way up. And exhale, relax your arms down by your side. Okay. Give that a little wiggle and a shake. We're gonna work our sun salutation B, so squats and lunges. This is definitely like a cardiovascular part of class, so just listen to your body, listen for the cues. All right, here we go. Inhale, arms up, reach up. Good, exhale, sit back for fierce pose, like a low squat. Right? Let your tail stick out, lift your chest, right? Let a little heat in, and then drive through your heels. Inhale, stand back up, reach up. Good, exhale to lunge, bring your right foot forward, left foot back. Just give yourself a moment to pause. Bring the right thigh bone back in space, left hip rolls forward, but actively press your left heel down. If you need to take up more space, you're welcome to widen your feet out a little bit, right? Inhale, arms up, chest up, warrior one. Just give yourself a couple breaths to notice, right? Take a little snapshot of what you're asking your muscles and your bones to do. Give it one more breath in. Exhale for side angle, right arm goes down, left arm open. Don't worry so much about your arm, really. This is about left rib cage, right? Twisting up and open. We're twisting into the spine here. And we'll come back up through warrior one. Take that breath in. Good, exhale, step to the top of your mat, feet together. Inhale, arms up. Good, exhale, sit back, fierce pose. Drive through your heels, inhale, stand back up. Exhale, left foot forward, right foot back to lunge. I'm just going slow on this first side to set everything up, get a nice strong foundation. working your left knee over your left ankle, pressing nice and strong through your back heel. Inhale, arms up, warrior one. Again, just a couple moments to ground. It's a warrior pose, right? This archetype of the strong warrior, so okay to feel strong and powerful here. Give it a breath. Exhale, side ankle, left arm down, right arm up and open. Again, feeling this twist of your chest and your rib cage opening up and open towards the right. And strong through the belly, let's come back up. Warrior one, and exhale, top of your mat, hands to your heart. All right, a little different here. Interlace your fingers behind your back. And again, kind of inviting the elbows and the shoulder blades together. You might even bring your knuckles kind of to, right, your sacrum, your lower back, the sort of flat bony part of your lower back. Right, and from here, you can stand up and just kind of press, right? Kind of feel this little back bending here, or maybe you bend your knees and come into that fierce pose. Ooh. All right, maybe we stay here. Maybe you come onto just one of your tippy toes. And set that heel down, maybe come onto the other tippy toe. Stay with that focus, bring both heels down. Maybe you come onto both of your toes. Both of your toes, both of your feet with your toes. Stay with it, breathe, just for three. Sit down in two. And one, good, go ahead and bring your heels down. Let's stand up and shake that out. We're gonna transition to our belly next and do a little bit of back bending on the belly. So you can go ahead and however you like, maybe gracefully or not so gracefully, make your way down all the way onto the belly. We're gonna set up for cobra pose, the Bhujangasana, feet together, zip your feet together, press the tops of your feet down, and bring your hands underneath your shoulders, right? So your elbows are up and back like you were like a cricket. Now, active through your legs, press the tops of your feet down, press your hips down. You're gonna feel your thighs engage here. Then inhale, lift your head, neck, and chest, and breathe, right? The low cobra pose. Your hands are here for support and leverage, but really there's not a whole lot of weight in the hands. This is really a lift, right, from your back muscles. Chest is pulling forward and up. We'll stay for one more full breath in. Good, exhale, lower down. And give yourself a moment just to rest, relax your legs. We're gonna flow through the cobra pose 5 times, right? So it's almost like we're doing a sit-up, but we're kind of crunching through the back muscles, right? The core wraps around the entire lower spine, right? So let this be a little bit of a core exercise, a spine strengthening exercise. So let's set it up, just do your best. Bring your thighs to touch, press your feet down, right? Elbows by your side. Here we go, strong through your legs, inhale, cobra. Exhale, lower. Inhale, cobra. Exhale, lower. Inhale, lift. Exhale, lower. Couple more, press down to lift up, breathe in. Exhale to lower. One more, inhale to lift. And exhale to lower. Good, you can make a little pillow here with your forearms, bend your knees. You give your feet here a little rock side to side. All right, use your hands here, start to press yourself up through sort of a tabletop position, and then scooch your legs and your bum off to one side. All right, so coming into a forward bend, we'll kind of move flexion and extension of the spine this way. So keeping the knees bent at least a little bit, you can kind of, again, just use your hands to move your butt out from underneath you, letting your pelvic bowl tilt forward, right? If you had a tail, your tail would be behind you, not tucked underneath. So sometimes folding over your mat or even sitting up on a cushion can be helpful here. Let's take a breath in to reach up. Exhale, fold forward. And we'll stay for a few breaths. And I just kind of notice the sensation in your lower back after all of that back bending that you've done today. Sort of feeling this forward bending. All right, go ahead and lift your chest up. We're gonna transition all the way onto the back, right? So coming into what is kind of like an active rest posture, knees bent, soles of the feet flat to the floor. And the setup on this is actually pretty important. So listen to the cues and set this up. Again, knees bent, soles of the feet flat to the floor. Feet are at least hip width distance, and then you're gonna walk your feet in towards your booty, kind of imagining you wanted to get your fingertips to touch the backs of your heels. Now from here, tuck your tail under. So if you did have a tail, you would be like a scared puppy, right? You're kind of like gluing your lower back down towards the ground, and you're gonna hold that action as you kick your heels down so much that your pelvis, your hips start to lift up. Right, Setu Bandhasana, the supported or the standing bridge pose. Now this might be a good place to just pause and check it out because your chest is coming up towards your chin. Create a little foundation underneath your chest. Maybe rock your shoulder blades together. Some of you might want to interlace your fingers, but continue to kick down and breathe. We're gonna hold it for like three breaths. If you need to come down early, you can. But again, just permission to ride alongside a little discomfort, a little challenge. That's super normal. It's true of yoga, right? It's true of life. Hang on to it. We're here. One more full big breath in. Ooh, nice and slow. Start to let your vertebrae, your spine slowly come down to the mat. Good. Kind of bend your knees in at your chest. Might feel good to give yourself a little squeeze or a little rock side to side. One of my favorite poses, we'll do legs up the wall. So staying on your back is heavy, heavy, heavy here. You can just let your legs float up towards the ceiling. If this feels like a lot, you can use your hands behind your knees for support. And then from here, I'm gonna invite you just to wiggle your ankles and your toes. You might kind of just let your whole legs do just a little free dance here. And then gently, we're gonna bring the feet back down to the ground. Feet hip width distance at least, right? Bring your knees out wide here. Gently knock your knees side to side. And as you do this, right, you're internally and externally rotating the thigh bone in the hip socket. You're gonna feel your pelvis, right, sort of tilt side to side. A little pressure here into the glute. Might feel kind of good after that back bending. Good. Then for our last posture before final rest will be one of my favorites. It's called the banana asana. And it's just like it sounds. We're gonna turn into a banana. So keeping your both hips on the ground, and you're just gonna walk your feet over to the right. Okay? And then again, both hips are rooted and heavy. See if you can just kind of shimmy your upper body over to the right. So you're in this banana shape. It's a big lateral side stretch, right? Maybe you stay here. If you wanna deepen the upper body stretch, you can reach your arms up overhead. It can also feel nice just to bring one hand to the belly and one to the heart. So you can choose. But stay just passively, really let the weight of your own body and gravity kind of help you open up into this side body stretch. And then let's scooch it to the other side. Other side, banana. So feet walk over to the left. Upper body shimmies to the left. Thank goodness this is not a ballet class. Just make your way there. And we'll stay for a few breaths. It's kind of like chilling in a hammock or something on a beach. That's what this pose is kind of like. Tropical banana pose. Start to make your way back through center. Good. Relax your arms down. We're going to come into a final resting posture. So you have a couple choices here. I'll invite you to do Baddha Konasana, Supta Baddha Konasana, soles of the feet together, knees out wide. Or maybe an active rest here, knees bent, soles of the feet flat to the floor. You're welcome to close down your eyes. Maybe bring one hand to your heart, one to your belly. And we'll stay for just a few conscious breaths. Start just by, again, noticing the points of contact between your body and the floor. And just entertain me a little bit here. Right, just this idea, maybe, of really allowing the weight of you, all of you, your muscles, your bones, but also whatever sort of energetic or mental sort of qualities you're carrying with you today. Just allowing all of that to be supported by the ground. Inhale, feel your belly and your chest rise. Exhale, feel them fall. If you have more time, take more time. If you're ready to move on, gently roll over onto one side all the way. And you can use your hands and your arms to press yourself all the way up to a seat. And to close out class together today, I'm going to invite you to bring your hands together and to kind of just rub them back and forth, bringing a little bit of energy. You might feel just a little friction or heat between your palms. And in that energy, using your imagination, you might set an intention, a positive affirmation or a wish or a prayer. You need to take that energy and that intention and put it right into your heart. Give it a big breath in. Breath out. And I'll bring my hands to my heart to bow forward and say thank you. Thank you so, so much.